now we are ready to go live to CARE Hospital for a live cases of peripheral angiogram, angioplasty.
We have a live case transmission coming over from CARE Hospital, where the interesting coronary as well as structural heart case will be presented.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, go ahead. Morning.
This is a 58-year-old lady who actually had chest pain a week ago and presented to us with LVF. She is diabetic and hypertensive for more than 10 years now. QS complexes in V1 to V4. At admission, the LV function was almost like a moderate LV dysfunction at an EF around 40. And now it's improved to a good LV function. Recurrently, she's been having angina on and off in the last 2 days. And we'll show you the pictures now. She has a single vessel disease.
Can you show the focus?
You are able to see the angiogram pictures?
Yeah, focus on the fluoro.
Are you able to see the picture, sir?
No. You are being shown. Let them show the fluoro.
Fluoro chupichandi. She has a good LV function now. You are able to see the pictures now, sir? Hello?
Yeah, we are able to see it.
Yeah, so basically has a single vessel disease. RCA is normal. Has a LAD disease which is starting from the ostium. Has a small stump there. But if you see in the epicranial, has a long segment disease extending almost up to the mid LAD. Vessel beyond is disease free. The D2, which is a sized vessel, has a 70% ostial stenosis. How do you think we should go ahead with this?
Yeah, obviously proximal LAD, long segment disease, some involvement of the diagonal. The question comes nowadays, especially with surgeons doing off pump, but you have selected this because you have to demonstrate a good live transmission. That discussion.
Actually, tell you very frankly, we had given them the option of CABG. They are not very keen on CABG.
Yeah. So, what stage are you now? Go ahead and
Now we'll be starting. We'll show you a wire that we wanted to use. It's called the BMW Elite.
Abbott has come out with a new this Elite wire.
Can you just focus here?
I have a point at this time whether we should do a prior any imaging technique like IVUS or to see the landing zone.
The proximal, you mean?
Yeah, the distal also landing zone because there is some haziness in the mid LED.
Actually, that's the plan.
Yeah. More than the distal, the proximal,
proximal
imaging
as well.
Is important because whether the disease is starting right from the distal left main, it has some implications. I think the angiography, they are pretty confident that's no, not planned maybe. That point is well taken.
Will be doing the IVUS after we cross.
Okay.
This is the BMW Elite wire. It almost, on the face of it, it looks like a regular BMW wire, except that it is a core to tip, so probably the torqueability will be much better. And there is a hydrophilic coating over it.
So it's already pre-shaped or you shaped it?
This is pre-shaped. It comes both as a straight wire as well as a pre-shaped J wire.
Okay.
This is the one we have taken the J wire and I'm not sure if you are able to appreciate.
Yeah, we are able to see it well.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Part of it is hydrophilic coated. So we thought we'll go ahead with that.
There is an option in this wire where at 45 millimeters there is a gold marker as well. So that would actually help us in sizing as well.
So, as was mentioned by one of the panelists, we thought we actually did. QSA and then the length of the lesion has come to around 52 millimeters. The plan was to go ahead with an absorb stent and as we know there are some specific sizes which are available in absorb. So we thought we'll have a clear cut plan beforehand before we go ahead with the selection of the stent. So in order to be sure as to the exact length, we thought we should go ahead with the IVUS and then make sure that we are sure about the size before we select the stents. It seems to be going into the diagonal.
This wire shape, what is done, looks better to enter the access to into the diagonal type of branches. When we want to enter, that is the shape which is preferable for benefit of everybody, it's preferable to use. But here they're trying to go into the LED, and that's fine. But in general, when you are doing a LED diagonal type of this thing, that sort of shape is generally, it's intentionally going straight into the, I think they have crossed. What is that marker, can for the benefit of everybody, can you show how is it being used to measure the lesion?
So that is at 45.
45?
Yeah.
That is at 45 millimeters from the tip of the wire.
Okay. So if you have to measure the length, I repeat some of the points for the benefit of everybody here. Is the tip to the marker, suppose you have to exactly measure the length of the lesion, it is 45 millimeters, that's how it is. Some of the wires have markers up to 29 millimeters, older ones, this is at 45. Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, we wanted an opinion. Now, the plan is to go ahead with Absorb. It's a recent anterior wall MI. There doesn't seem to be any obvious calcium, at least on the fluoro. I think we should pre-dilate. We thought we should pre-dilate because it's a tight stenosis. Do a pre-dilatation, do a IVUS, and then go ahead with the stenting. Any comments on that? Absorb, would you like to directly with IVUS and do a direct stenting or?
No, unless patient has acute MI or ACS type scenario where you expect slow force to happen, it's always better to predilate and prepare the bed well and take the stents, more so with BVS. Though we have now data coming up showing that it could be placed, but here is long segment disease, your plan is acceptable and please.
There is actually some amount of calcium as well there.
Yeah, the
stent would be an issue because Absorb that way profile is slightly more than routine metallic stent we have.
Yeah, now we had live transmission coming up yesterday where Absorbs are being placed even in calcified lesions, but it is always better, preparation of the lesion becomes very important when you're
this is a 2.5.
Any comments on the diagonal? How many of you would probably put in a wire and protect that diagonal before putting in a stent?
Basically, we decide on protecting the branches. Branch is big, one. Second is whether lesion, ostium of the side branch has a disease or not. So if you find the ostium is diseased, it is always important to protect that branch. But again, there are two fuels of thought, whether you predilate and do it, then sometimes you end up producing more problems. So, but wiring, there's no problem. Whenever there is doubt, you always better wire larger branches, but here they are very confident, probably because it's free from disease, that's how it's not wired, but by and large it is preferable to wire, especially when the branches are larger. I think one point about predilatation, in real world we tend to predilate with shorter balloons, even the longer lesions, because we can't obviously take long lesions, longer balloons because of availability other things, but the more number of times you predilate in various sessions, not in this type of lesion, especially in ACS, you tend to produce more problems. So little longer balloon, one go is always preferable, especially when the lesion is not very tight, where you expect that balloons would cross easily. It's preferable to have a little longer balloon to cover it up once and then predilate once. At least what angiographic picture suggests that you do have a small area where the stents could be placed and maybe left main is not involved. But sometimes you could also find out an IVUS more definitely that left main is okay. That's more important to decide on what strategy you follow. Go ahead and think.
Can we have any comments from the panelists as to how they approach the situation of acute coronary syndrome with the Absorb?
Cranial.
How do you actually, how do they decide to breed?
Dr. Dev, you want to comment?
Yes, we had a couple of cases done in the acute MI situation with Dr. Rath in the cath lab with the Absorb stent and with prior, as you said, preparing the patient lesion well and getting a TME3 flow before you go for the Absorb stent, and these patients had good outcome without any stent thrombosis. Only one patient had, I think out of four cases, one patient had a stent thrombosis. Others, three did very well with the acute MI situation.
Okay. Yeah. Can we see the IVUS?
We have just started the IVUS.
Let them focus on the IVUS screen, please.
Just projected.
The cameraman thinks you both are looking too smart, I think. He's
No, actually I was going to tell the same about you.
go ahead.
We might be looking smart but not as glamorous as you.
Then you are concentrating, your idea what you are telling is to see the distal extent of disease, is it?
Yes. The whole thing.
Exact idea.
It also helps in exact sizing of the diameter of the stent and then probably assessment of length when you three-dimensionally use it, a longitudinal section when you come, you can directly measure the length. That is the advantage of using a motorized pullback compared to a manual pullback and IVUS. This was highlighted upon in the IVUS course which was conducted also.
I think that's the disease segment starting there. And distally at least the normal segment appeared 3 years, so I think probably we can take
1, 2 and 2.75.
Because we don't have a 2.75 in absorbed stent
structure. That's what I was mentioning. The problem with presently available absorbed stent is only of the availability of the sizes. But I think for this lesion, even if you have to use two stents, if you feel that you are not covering up, and probably you can switch over and use whatever stents which suits the best, up to you.
See, there's a chunk of calcium which actually we passed that segment and there's more calcium coming up here.
Yeah.
So I think that we actually predilated it.
I think we could notice that the balloon actually gave way suddenly.
Yeah. We have now evidence to say that.
Go ahead.
Evidence to say that whenever there is calcium more in the superficial region is always better to predilate and prepare the bed well. It's good that they have dilated it already. And then now there's large amount of atheroma burden there, the proximal portion of LAD and eccentric type of lesion. Four then
some amount of dissection also there.
Because you're doing it post balloon, I think that is you're seeing some amount of dissection. Now this important aspect is when it is coming into the guide and
that's the L6-ostium.
Yeah, that's other branch is there which has come up.
LMCA looks pretty clean.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a short LMCA.
Can we just measure?
Can we see that last clipping once of IVUS?
Yeah, yes, short.
Where the branch L6 came and then you felt left main is free from disease?
Little plug, but I think otherwise it's a very short segment, short LMCA.
Okay.
LMCA appeared clear. I think the ostium of LAD definitely has a plug.
You'll need to stent it from the ostium, probably leave a strut in the LMCA because it's better to miss the ostium.
Yeah. In there, what they are doing below is a three-dimensional reconstructed longitudinal segment, longitudinal reconstruction, where you can directly measure the length from the proximal. How much it is? 49?
But we thought around 52.
So the challenge now is to take Acha.
If you have 18 and 28.
228.
You want to use 228?
Yeah, 328. We'll take a 328 initially, distally.
And 3.5.
Distally it came to 2.75. How much was it in IVUS?
Actually, the normal segment, visually it appeared 3 millimeter.
Okay.
So 328.
Probably if we are thinking of getting into the ostium of the LAD, would it be wise to put a wire in the circ and protect it? It's a large circumflex.
Yeah, if ostium of LCX is also diseased and left main has some plaque, it's definitely more relevant. But they felt there is some small stump at the ostium of LAD. But as you said, if you want to protect it, there is nothing wrong in it.
Ostium of LCX is completely clean actually.
Yeah, because ostium of LCX is clean, they're not thinking of doing it. For the sake of everybody, can you just focus when you're opening the BVS?
No, the first one you already opened, the second one which we opened
Can they focus on the stent once before? Now that it is, many people are already aware.
We'll do it on the next one.
That's like appearance is slightly different. It's more like a plastic.
Actually, we'll do it with the second stent when you open it. It's already on the wire. So
yeah, that's fine.
Yeah,
they've seen the stent on the wire. All the concerns which a company had before the opening and all that looks less and less important now, because the utility is more and it's more like a very pretty standard.
But CA typically absorb, there was a calcium, you can see actually on fluoroscopy also the calcium there, though it got well dilated with 2.5 millimeter balloon. You can see that it doesn't track.
That is another point when you're using absorb, the optimal sizing.
We'll pre-dilate it further.
Yeah, with a 2.75 balloon or 3 balloon.
One of the important things in these situations is generally it's recommended that once you have opened the stent, come in contact with blood or any other. So, that you try to implant
it.
Yeah, they said that you should do
it. Otherwise, there is a possibility that it might actually start expanding and it's even more difficult to push in that particular stent.
Would you suggest a rota at this point for the calcific?
Yes, three.
No, suppose if it's not possible even with the bigger size balloon, the next option remains that.
It's a slightly backward step in the probably technology of stent in terms of the crossability and profile stent. But the advantage is obviously something else, so probably it'll evolve over a period of time.
What is the plan like, Rajiv? In between, when you are working on this, can you switch to other lab where Nagesh Rao is showing something, or you will stay with you?
Not sure if they are ready. 1 second, we'll just let you know.
Okay.
So, children, doctor.
Just trying to pre-dilate with the 3 mm.
What is the antiplatelet regime you are using now for this?
She's on Prasugrel once daily, 10 milligram, and aspirin twice daily.
What was the protection when you pull out the BVS out of the bloodstream, and outside how you prepare again to push it back again?
Obviously, it's not recommended that they're forced to do it.
No, but sometimes we do have such situations.
Yeah, yeah.
So what should we do in such situations?
No, you try to do…
Just wash it with the saline.
And try to finish off the procedure as soon as possible so that you'll do it inside. The concern was the initial trace when we were part of absorb, once it comes out back, you are not allowed to put it back through the same guide. They are supposed, they were so strict that it could be moving and all that. Okay. That is less and less concerns now, because with experience we are using it more. So now whenever we, such episodes also we took it back and did it, not much of problems noted.
See that this, the waste there is dipping,
Water size is allowed.
Water feeding there.
What balloon you have taken now?
This is a 3 into 12 Maverick.
Okay.
You can see that.
NC balloon.
The problems with lower generation balloons is they have too much of shoulders like that, proximal distal to the markers. Mm-hmm. Then you should be very careful when you are positioning it in the ostium, because it could be also producing dissections in left main.
Very true.
They are anyway away. Luckily, calcific point is in the mid segment. That's not an issue here.
Yes. Sometimes high pressure NC balloon inflation can cause just like a sprinkler into the, dissection or kind of…
Yeah, but here the what they inflated is quite far off from left main, I think it should be okay. Are we going into the BVS?
Yeah, we're going into the BVS. There is some amount of dissection in the proximal segment because of these high pressure inflations.
Yeah, I think now it crossed easily. So it again highlights the fact that pre-dilatation with optimal sized balloon is very important, especially when you're taking BVS.
It is always the BVS. BVS is an essential for preparing the bed. And also for any sort of stent, particularly this, to reduce the
Another important thing while
stenosis
inflating
and also your thrombosis. We have to prepare the bed properly.
Yeah.
And also the, in some cases also the post-deployment, post-dilatation, high pressure post-dilatation. That is very essential.
Important.
3NC next. 3NC.
What pressure are you at?
We have been inflating about 2 atmospheres every 5 seconds.
Yeah.
So we are about reaching around 10 atmospheres.
What they are meddling is the inflation method which is described for BVS is the slow gradual inflation. That's what they are highlighting, but I think people are doing it faster also nowadays. I think it's opened up there. And,
yeah,
when you get the balloon back, you can get it back and inflate it further once, I think.
You mean the balloon or? Probably size it with this itself. Epicardial.
Yeah.
Epicardial.
Post dilatation, we would probably take a 3NC balloon, which we have already opened.
Is also available.
This is again one method to check whether the similar size tent would be enough. Anyway, it is there. While coming out, you take a picture. You have to be more definite about what is the size of length needed. That's what they did. And one more thing which you can do is, when you move it back, if so you feel some sort of residual disease there in the proximal or mid-segment of the stent, because you are worried to inflate it more with the same stent because of stent pressure inflation as well as distal dissection, now you get it back and you have a lot of length, even the back, you can inflate it with a higher pressure in the middle.
You could see that.
So now you're planning to take 328?
I'm not sure. I thought it was slightly less. Scene minus. You could see that the balloon is outside the marker. The proximal position is good, but distally it's not covering the stent. So
okay.
I don't think 28 will be sufficient. Better to go ahead with 33 or...
Or maybe 218s, but the overlap would be too much.
Yeah, you need to consider patients' cast issues also. Then you can decide, sure. You always better to get away with one stent with longer length if possible, but only thing is if patient is particular about getting BVS done, then we have no choice because of size limitations.
I think we'll go ahead with
218 is better.
Yeah. 318.
Initially there were some concerns with the overlapping stents of BVS, but now we have data presented even in TCT and the data shown that even overlap segments also can be done. And the absorption follow-up studies are also there with follow-up overlaps of BVS.
I think there have been some studies also where overlap they have looked at with the bioabsorbable.
Sorry, we didn't get you.
What is the recommended highest pressure inside BVS?
The recommended pressure is what is written there, but nowadays of late we go with slightly higher pressures, but what is mentioned is the size of the balloon what you take is more relevant. If you are taking the correct size balloon, then people are going to slightly higher pressures, but if you oversized balloon and give go to high pressure, it's more likely to produce problems of struts. But in a 3 stent, you are taking 3 size balloon, people do go up to high pressures now.
We'll just show you the stent,
yeah.
Opening the stent, how to open.
Discussing that he went up to the 28.
Yeah. Optimum size balloon size.
But you have to recommended the maximum size of the balloon. You have to comply that while considering the pressure.
We're going into the 318 now.
If possible, we should always try to avoid having the exact overlapping point at the branch origin, because it's always better not to have overlap unless we'll see how it fits in, how the 18 is ending.
Yeah, I think we'll go in.
Obviously, we are forced to because of sizes, but otherwise, if you can take a little longer and the shorter one proximally to avoid the diagonal, it will be always better, but because here we have no choice because of sizes availability being.
You can see the disc marker and the balloon, balloon tip, probably we just keep it proximal to that so that we have adequate overlap. Generally about 0.7 millimeter and 1.2 millimeter.
You have a fine marker scene.
Generally,
if you can zoom marker it
to
up
marker, generally there is a 2 millimeter overlap.
Yeah.
So,
we are not able to see the exact marker here, but it's okay. You may be seeing it better and go ahead. The problem with the BVS as of now is that the stent is not radio opaque. We have to go with only the small marker which is radio opaque. Yeah. To decide regarding it, and research on future other technology says to make a BVS opaque. Already Riva is another stent which is coming up which is has a opaque BVS in the research protocols. What pressure are you on now?
Now
it is slightly opening up. Patient is tolerating the procedure, all
right?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I think you can go a little in and then give an inflation at the overlap point. That will cover that small residual disease.
Probably
also
do it with another NC later on.
Dr. Srinivas Kumar, you are able to hear me?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. There were some loose connections.
How much pressure they went in with? Did you hear?
How much pressure did you give? That's what he's asking.
Gone up to 16.
16.
As Srinivas Kumar mentioned, the previous fear which was there as far as the pressure is concerned, that's no longer there, and the resting strength of absorb is supposed to be as good as any other DS. So we can actually use it as any other DS. The only constraint is the diameter. So we don't want a 3 mm stent there and a 3.5 dia balloon to inflate it. So that's the only concern, but pressure as such should not be an issue. I think we'll go ahead with a 3.5 18 and then finish the procedure. We have 3.5 12 also, but I think we fall short, sir. 3.5 18.
18 and 12 may not be sufficient because previously when you measured that 28
was falling. Yeah, it appeared
at least
33 or something, sir.
Probably the slow overlap may be a little bit more.
Since proper debulking was not done at the calcific area, which was not being opened properly, even maybe after a higher balloon inflation.
Yeah, that's what he's telling. Yeah. He would like to predilate throughout with an NC balloon later.
So all the time with BVS, should we not go with the proper debulking? Like
yes, that's absolutely what we should
what
be doing.
What was the recommendation?
Yes, ma'am. Your point is well taken. This positioning of the stent proximally again is very important, especially in your dealing with it. For benefit of beginners, you check it in multiple views, apical and iliocaudal, and depending upon the branching pattern, you decide exactly in the positioning, because some of the latest type of stents which start with the marker are more preferable when you're positioning it in the osteo locations.
For those of you who are coming late, this is an LAD long segment lesion.
We'll come back a little.
And two biodegradable stents, biovascular scaffolds have already been deployed, and third one is being deployed to complete the case. I just hope we have enough time.
So.
We can actually see the marker very well here.
Yeah, if you keep a dark portion in the left main, automatically I think you will be doing it. The balloon marker, it's placed in the left main, then probably it just starts distal to it, it should be okay.
What's the distance between the balloon marker and the stent marker? I can't see that distance here.
Yeah, it's okay.
I'll come back after we start inflating a little.
We can see the marker, doesn't seem to have...
It's moved again. One of the techniques to avoid the movement of the stents more closely when it raises, one is holding respiration, then second one probably it's also to take the guide more deeper in and to say avoid too much movement while placing in the ostium.
This looks okay?
Yeah.
Iliocaudal. So generally in these situations we tend to, I think, enough time make sure that the position before we actually go ahead with the inflation. Sini. This is fine?
Yeah. It's moving each time, that's so you should be just careful while inflating.
Okay. Yeah. Sini.
That looks okay.
It's possible. Balloon will inflate.
Yeah.
I think this is one of the situations where though it's absorbed.
You can get the guide a little back, I think, to avoid becoming too much ischemic to that. So now that it is inflated.
You see the LCX is still patent.
Yeah, filling all right.
From PVP cordon.
Slow inflation.
Three point five twelve.
Is there any concern on the radial strength of the BBS?
Generally, no, madam. The radial strength of Absorb is supposed to be as good as any other DES. It compares well with Zyne's, the Zyne strength. So, unless we upsize the radial strength, should not be an issue.
I think that looks good.
One cranial. You can see that obviously probably the proximal extent of the stent is under dilated, and as was mentioned, the place where that calcium is there seems to be significant residual. The
slightly diagonal ostium I think is looks slightly pinched, and you can work on it. I think if you're running short of time here, as you are working further with this, can we go to the other lab?
Yeah.
Is the lab ready, the other lab ready?
My colleague, Dr. Nagesh Rao, is a pediatric cardiologist. He will brief the summary of the patient, and then we have already done some kind of…
Good morning, chairpersons and panelists over there. Welcome to Pediatric Cardiology Department, Care Hospital. I am going to present a case, a 3-year-old girl who weighs 11.5 kilograms, diagnosed as large aorta pulmonary window, which is type 3. And a large membranous VST with inlet extension. She underwent cardiac surgery in the month of May 2013, that is 3 months back, using autologous glutaraldehyde treated pericardium. The post-operative period was uneventful. However, the echocardiogram showed on day 3 little bit of residual leak from the AP window suture. Child behaved very well, hence we did not do anything. But during the follow-up after 2 weeks, the AP window, residual AP window size has been increased quite significantly. She became symptomatic. So, the assessment showed, next slide, That is the cardiac thoracic ratio. You can see that that is the post-operative, which is 65% with increased vascularity. Next, the ECG showing volume overload with a high voltage mid-precordial leads. Next, you can see this is the pre-operative echo, which is showing a large VST. Next, so that is the pre-operative AP window, which is quite significant. Next. So this is a post-operative follow-up echocardiogram. Can you click on that? Yeah. Yeah, you can see that this is the residual AP window in one of the plane. The maximum dimension which we measured is 8 millimeters. So we thought we'll close the AP window with a transcatheter closure because child is quite symptomatic and cardiomegaly is present. So we have taken the child. I want to introduce our anesthesia. Dr. Shomita is there, pediatric anesthetist. Sister, technician, and my mentor Dr. Raghavaraju is here. So we have done baseline hemodynamic data. We have performed the 4-French arterial puncture here. We kept a 4-French sheath, and initially we put a 6-French venous sheath, then exchanged it to 8-French Mullens. We did the oximetry. Pulmonary artery saturation is 98%, whereas FA saturation is 100%. We have quite a significant step up, more than 3:1 shunt, whereas the pulmonary artery pressures are 60 millimeters over 30 millimeters of mercury, whereas the aortic pressures, which is 130 over 40, which showed wide pulse pressure. So that is what we are. Raghavaraju, I request Raghavaraju sir to explain the steps what we have done now.
Let us show them the angiographic images and then explain the procedure. Okay. You can go ahead. Show yeah.
Scene directory.
Yeah.
First.
Go ahead. You go ahead. You go ahead. No, if you see the multipurpose catheter was positioned in the main pulmonary artery, and then the wire you had seen in the aorta, and then the child has right aortic arch. Next.
Go back.
Angios. Now, this is the aortic root angio. You can see that there is a simultaneous filling of the inject into the aorta. The main pulmonary artery is seen. The communication is seen. Interestingly, this communication seems to be a little closer to the left main coronary artery. That's what I cautioned my pediatric cardiologist, said that we have to be careful in positioning the device. Okay, next view. That was the AP view. This is the RAV view. You can see the left coronary there, and the pulmonary artery is filling. And this is 90 degrees lateral view. Several views were done to profile the track so that while deploying, we have enough anatomical information and then to position the disc. And this is in the yellow, 30 degrees. We found that this view is useful for positioning the device to close the communication. As you said, my colleague said that the aortic pressure and the pulmonary artery pressure near identical, about 20 to 30 millimeters of gradient is there between the PA and the aorta, large communication causing some kind of more than 3:1 shunt. Okay, so once confirming the track, then we wanted to establish in the AV loop, we wanted to close the communication from the venous side. This is the right coronary 5-French. Go ahead. Now, you can see that we crossed the communication with the 2-5 glide wire and then advanced the diagnostic catheter. Right. Next. From the aorta through the communication into the LPA. We left the wire in the LPA. We wanted to snare from the RPA. The wire is in the RPA, and then, okay.
So we have a snare catheter. The RPA as well as the wire in RPA. Next.
We took the R plus gooseneck 20 millimeter loop snare, opened the snare. Next. We could easily catch the wire in the RPA and establish the AV loop. Right femoral vein to the right femoral artery AV loop. Next. Then from the venous approach, we took a Malin sheath, Cook 8 French, 63 millimeter long, and over the wire, and both kissing the catheter with the sheath, we could easily manipulate into the PA, crossed the communication between the aorta and the PA. Next. And you could see that we have manipulated the sheath, 8 French sheath from the femoral vein, IVC, RV, PA, and then the AP window into the descending thoracic aorta.
So here we have a right aortic arch and right descending aorta. So that's where the catheter, the sheath position looks a little bit abnormal here because of the right aortic arch. AP window is one of the congenital artifices where the right aortic arch is associated. So here we'd like to take questions from the panelists and audience. So you have seen a post-operative residual VST which measures, can you show the measurement picture, echocardiogram which measures around 8 millimeter, angiocardiogram in shallow LVO measures around 7.7, 8 millimeters. So we have already decided what we want to do. Probably you can also suggest or generate some discussion, then we'll go ahead and deploy the device.
If they have enough time, you can.
Yeah, if you have enough time.
Nageshwar, please go ahead and show the device delivery, please.
Okay.
Because
so, since it is a 8 millimeter, a post-operative autologous pericardium, we thought we'll put a muscular VST device. So, we thought we should have stability on either side because of the autologous pericardium, which may not give proper support, number one. Number two, PA pressures are higher side. So that's the reason we need to put a device which should hold on either side. So this Harter, you can see it's a equivalent of the Ampraxger group of family. You can see that two discs on either side and a central waist measuring around 7 millimeters with a diameter of 10 millimeter with a dacron, double dacron here. This is what the device profile.
Sir.
Don't waste time.
Sir, one. Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Sir, what's the option for membranous device in this case?
Yeah, we can do membranous VST device as well, but the retention disc diameter in membranous disc is slightly lesser. So I'm really worried if the autologous pericardium gets scrambled, it may not be unstable. So that's why I thought the muscular VST probably is a better option. I do agree membranous symmetrical device, not asymmetrical
yes, sir,
device.
Yes, membranous symmetrical
that
device.
That has got 3 millimeters length of the inter-disc length, but here it is a little bit bigger so that we have more room here rather than there. The either side of LV disc and RV disc diameter are going to be higher in the muscular compared to the membranous VST, what LifeTech manufactures. Whereas it is not available in the Ampraxger groups, hence we thought we'll take this device.
Because sir, there is concern because it may compromise with the RP or the aortic side.
Well, let us see whether we have more room, PS are dilated. Let us see, we have a question that whether the PA end will cause RPA obstruction, stenosis and all. We'd like to see that, but yeah. First our preference is this rather than the membranous VST here in this particular situation because the constriction will not be formed with the membranous properly. The experience of the SERA membranous is not much in the world or even individual experience. So muscular VST experience is quite significant, hence we thought we'll first use this and then see. So this is what the device. Device is loaded. So we are using the 7 groin sheath here to load. Actually this device goes through 7 French also, but we have taken 8 French Mullen's sheath here. So we are just de-airing.
Yeah, let them focus on the device loading. Yeah. They are showing the fluoro picture.
So I'll just redeploy and then reload it.
That's fine. The idea is to avoid air bubble entanglement there and keep flushing and then get it onto this thing and then.
Okay, we are ready to go. We intentionally kept the sheath in the descending aorta because Mullen sheath has got primary and tertiary curves here. If you have tertiary curve,
crossed.
So it's easily going.
Go ahead, you do everything. There shouldn't be any.
So generally, this is where the area where sheath falls, especially when you are doing RSOV. So I thought we'll just make point that in RSOV also, when you put the sheath, it's better to keep in the distal transverse art.
We have partially opened the distal disc. Okay, in the aorta.
Center table.
Give it. This is okay?
Yeah.
Okay, we are deploying the distal disc. Mind you, we are in the ascending aorta from the arch. We cross the arch vessels. Meet these kind. Okay.
Yeah.
From the device. Yeah.
Yeah, we have deployed the distal disc completely and then trying to engage the.
We'll just confirm echo one.
Check on echo.
Communication on the aortic side.
So in this case, is it better to take one pigtail also nearby to see where the disc is deployed?
Yeah, we'll do that because lot of contrast may be needed. So we'll just see whether we are close to the AP window. Go to long.
Can
AP.
The show focus on the echo, please?
Aorta long AP.
Ask the cameraman to show. Okay.
Okay, echo is not going to be useful here. Yeah, I can just see the device just close to the
above the
AP window. Very, very close.
Yeah.
I think we'll do the angiogram here and then go for the deployment. Maybe you can reduce the volume 10 ml, 12 flow, 700 psi, 30 frames per second.
Okay.
Because here the initial concern Dr. Raghuraju sir told, these are also close to the defect. So
it's important
better.
To correctly position it.
Total device.
Okay. Okay. You do it.
Okay. Okay. Ready for the angio? Fill the catheter.
Okay.
The screen, sir.
Okay, we are doing the aortic root angio.
So we are very, very close to the AP window. I think this is the time to deploy the device.
You do it. No. Under Cindy.
Okay, now let us see the echocardiogram. You can show the hemodynamics.
Hemodynamics.
There. Pressure has come down quite significantly.
PA pressure has come down to almost normal. The aortic echo. Pressure remains same.
Okay. Echo. Show the pulmonary artery, short axis view, whether RPA is compromised. Color it. LPA flow is very good. We are going to profile RPA. Shiva is doing echo. Yeah, RPA flow is very good. You can see that bifurcation here. Just reduce the 2D gain.
Yeah.
So we can do a sheath injection here to profile the pulmonary artery, then we will take the aortic injection before we deploy. Shiva, remove your hand. We will probably do in AP or
whichever you.
Come to RAO 30. There's a lot of traction on the device. I'll just push the cable so that this is the going to this is going to be the final position. Okay.
Sheath and again, P was there.
Okay. Injection.
Aortal injection. I mean, injecting into the PA. You can see that with this injection, only the PA is filling.
So both RPA and LPA, we took because the RPA needs to be profiled better than the LPA. That's the reason. Both are filling very nicely. We'll do the aortic root angiogram and then we'll we'll assess echocardiogram. If the
12
same LAO view.
LAO view. We'll keep, take large volume.
Yeah. 12 ml, 12 flow, 700 PSI. The baseline view.
Okay. Are you okay?
1 second, sir. Okay.
Oh. Are you ready? Once again, we are taking the angiographic picture of the aortic root and see what's happening to the communication. You can see that the distal disc is well anchored to the communication and the aorta.
Maybe the AP window size is a little bit exaggerated by our echo as well as angio, because why I'm talking like that, you can see the constriction of the central vase, which is coming nearly 6 or 7 millimeter. Probably 80 device also would have been okay, but I personally feel the post-operative residual situation, we should be a bit aggressive in putting bigger sizes.
It's always better, sir.
You can see that we are quite away from the
So, if everybody accepts, we are ready to deploy the device.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay.
Some shunt, which is residual shunt, which is seen probably once you release the device, it gets to slow.
To the device itself,
because device
that is
known
as foaming. When the device gets thrombosed, the shunt
won't be.
So it took its shape very nicely.
Final picture. We'll wait for a couple of minutes and then.
We can do aortic root angiogram, not necessarily now because we have seen before. I think we'll show you the echo picture. That is probably better than. Show the pulmonary artery. Yeah, color it. So you can see the pulmonary artery. Both RPA, LPA, and there is no shunt. Reduce the color gain scale little bit, increase. Now it is 60. Yeah, now it is 60. Keep it 70. So you can see that device is there. Pulmonary artery is very grossly dilated. There is a room.
That is why
I
think there is no obstruction.
There is no obstruction. You can take a Doppler of main pulmonary artery.
Yeah, I think there is no turbulence seen, but for some mild intral device turbulence.
Continuous view.
Thank you, Dr. Ivaraj and Dr. Nageshwar for excellent demonstration.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.